Welcome back to the checkpoint. We are checking on the NSSF this evening with me, Vivian Kamsine. Now, Mr. Patrick, I am wondering, what is the update on the startup program at the fund?
You know, what happened is about 2 years ago, we realized one thing. For NSSF to grow, there are two things you have to do. One, make sure that your revenues are more than your expenses. That net surplus, we call it organic growth. You'll grow. Or new contributions come in. Where do the new contributions come from? When members get higher salaries, more contribution will come in. But however, what's happening to most companies today? The big companies, when you leave a company today, most likely they redistribute your job, but not redistribute your entire salary. So we can actually see the growth coming from salary increments is narrowing. The last area is you get new members. So we realize that this economy is not creating enough jobs. Tell you how many students, how many people finish university and they don't have jobs, a lot of them. Now, how are jobs created? If you look at all economies, whether the US, whether Europe, whether Africa, 70% of the jobs come from small and growing businesses. Now, if you look at the ecosystem in Uganda, how are jobs growing? We have four stages. People have wonderful ideas. We call it ideation. They pilot whether or not that idea will work, a startup. If that works, then they try it. Will somebody actually buy my product? We call that commercialization. When those three are lined up, they scale. Now, in the scaling area, there's enough money. The banks are waiting for you. In the commercialization stage, there's some money, private equity is there. You won't even believe. In ideation, the startup, there's enough resources. Kampala alone has 28 business incubation centers. So if you want to have an idea how to clean up your business, there's enough resources. What's happening is in the pilot, the startups, we call it the death valley, the businesses die because nobody is putting any money in a startup. So we decided, okay, let's experiment, and we borrowed a model from the US. Let's experiment, and together with MasterCard Foundation, we said, okay, let's try to see if we can inject about 75 million shillings in a startup. So our first group was actually February last year. We funded 27. We had funded 5 in a pilot that gave us a lot of lessons that we learned. Interestingly enough, we found that a lot of entrepreneurs have tunnel vision. I have my idea. It's a good idea. I'm going to do my idea. Good. Except you don't know that your business to succeed has got a number of elements you need to also learn. You need to learn about managing people. You need to learn about customer service. You need to learn about marketing. You need to learn about... So what we did is we built an academy that we have now that has 8 modules. So the requirement is somebody has to enroll in our academy, finish it. When you are done,
you get... Is the academy like a school?
Yes, it's online.
Okay.
So when you're done, you finish. Once you've registered, you then buy. When you're done with that academy, you actually have a business plan because it's interactive. You have a business plan, and then from the business plan, we shortlist who will pitch before a panel of very eminent Ugandan businessmen in Uganda here who are prominent business people. You pitch that idea before them, and they shortlist you for funding, and we do. So in Feb. 27 startups. In November, 78 qualified. They are going through a due diligence now. We're going to fund them. We had about 9,000 entrepreneurs enroll in the academy between those two classes. But we realized one thing, that most of the businesses were male-dominated. So we decided to do a cohort for women-led, women-owned businesses. 2,900 women enrolled in the class. Last week, 250 of them were shortlisted to go through the boot camp. We hope we'll fund 100 by the end of March. The goal is to fund 500 over the next 3-4 years. And the way we are thinking is this. Survival rate for businesses in Uganda is very low, about 10%. So if we fund 500, and only 10% survive, 50 survive, But they become the MTNs, they become the UBC, they become the UBLs in the next 10 years. Then we would have built our own future where our workers and our members will come from. So that, in essence, is a problem. Very exciting problem. I think we're even going to scale it from 500 to 1,000 because there are other people who are coming who want to be party with us in terms of doing this.
Yes, that's a very exciting future indeed. But can you just elaborate for us again, take us back to how does someone enroll for that academy?
Okay. If you are there and you are listening, just go to our website, score nssfug.org. Then you just look for, there's a menu, High Innovator. Press High Innovator, you enroll, you can start the classes today.
The menu is on your website?
Yes.
Okay. So once someone is on your website, then they should
be able to access. High Innovator and yes. They can do that. Or you can even Google, just type High Innovator and it will lead you to the site.
Do you have a specific interest in, you know, like you just said,
Women
of a certain age group, maybe the young people? You know that currently
yes.
Our population is mainly filled with the youth.
We are focusing a lot on the youth, but
yes.
Doesn't mean an older person can't get on there. The thing is, what we are looking to, the three criteria we're looking for a business are this. You won't even believe this. The potential to have impact. That your business will have a serious impact on Ugandans. Number two, the potential to scale it. We can actually grow you and become bigger. The third one, the potential for sustainability. The potential for it to be profitable because it's a business. So we actually, as you go through this program, those are the three things we are narrowing on. We know you're just starting up. So you don't have books. We know you're just starting up. You don't have profits. We know that. So we are measuring potential. The good thing is when we invest in you, we don't leave you. It's a marriage. By the way, it's not for free. Because with the little money we give you, we take what's called an option to turn that into a 6% equity investment for us. So from that, we are married. We work together. Out of the 27, there are 7 now who are beginning to scale up. So we brought other funding partners to fund them with at least $100,000 to $150,000 to make them grow bigger. So we stay with you until you either die or grow.
That's an interesting one. But how do you stay with them? How do you do the evaluation into their businesses?
What we have across the country now, we have got hubs, business hubs. We have signed up so far 12. They have got branches in different parts of the country. So it doesn't matter whether somebody is in Kabale or Gulu, there is a hub near you that provides you with that support, follow up with you so that you can, there's always help near you so that you can actually do that. And now we've overlaid that with business support services. So wherever you are, wherever your business is, you're actually there and you can actually get there. But the success has been amazing. If I just give you one example, there was a company, Arua Honey Pride in Arua. This guy just wanted to have, he had been, I think, trying to do honey for the longest time, but he knew his stuff. He knew his business.
Yeah.
He just wanted to buy a machine that would help him package that honey. $15,000, around 68 million shillings, let's say. And he bought the machine in Feb. He has employed 11 people today. He has become an aggregator of the other farm, of other honey producers around his area. He's exporting Southern Sudan. Only
business is making impact.
Only 75 million shillings, and the guy is taking off.
Okay. Now, what you're telling us takes us back to the fund's investment strategy.
Yes.
Does the fund have the full discretion to invest as they choose, or is there restrictions on requirements that need to be considered?
The regulator has set up what we call investment guidelines. Our regulator is UBRA, has set up the investment guidelines. How much you can put in a certain asset class.
Yes.
Now, so those guidelines are there. Like we say, we can't invest outside East Africa. It has to be within East Africa. Then from those investment guidelines, we then develop what we call the investment policy statement for us. because we have unique needs to meet our members and so on. The board approves that investment policy statement and we file it with the regulator. We review it every year, and that allows the type of mix of assets we are going to have. For example, right now we have, for example, in terms of bonds, our range, ideal range, is between 70 to 80% of the portfolio to be what? In the bonds.
Yeah.
Right now it's 78. Why? Because bonds are the safest. I remember I told you that our value proposition is what? Is safety. Bonds are the safest places for you to invest. And if you look at our investment mix over the last 5 years, that number, that ratio hasn't changed. Equity, we put about 15%, mostly in Kenya. And then real estate, which gives us the most headache, by the way. It's only 7% of the portfolio.
Don't you get pressure from government officials?
About what?
About those bonds, about you having to invest in those bonds so that they could have money coming through.
By the way,
yes.
If we don't go, sometimes they cancel the auction. Because the bond the government sells when it borrows, they're not just borrowing from us. They're borrowing from us. And now Uganda government bonds have very good rates. So you're competing with the Germans, with the Japanese, you're going with the Americans, we're competing with banks. But as a domestic holder, when we go, we help lower the rate a little bit for the country.
Okay. Then tell us a little bit about the procedures or what you do when someone saves with you. For example, when the employer deposits my saving,
yes,
with you,
yes,
what happens to that money?
As soon as you deposit the money on your account, the first thing you do, you'll hear, you'll get an alert,
yes,
that, hey, we received some money for you. This is your provisional balance. But that money lands in a bank because the employer has put money in different banks. We transfer that money. If we transfer that money to our account, say, by 9 a.m., by 11 a.m., we've invested it. We don't have idle cash.
All of it?
All of it. We don't hold idle cash. We invest it there and then.
How? Oh. Do you have guidelines, maybe from your regulator, that,
yeah,
10% of it is in bonds?
No.
Yes.
You don't look at it from individual deposits.
Yes.
From a portfolio perspective, you've got a range when you look at the entire portfolio. But what happens, even if I have to fix your money for that day, I will. The thing is, no idle cash. For example, the auctions occur once a month by Bank of Uganda. But there are also secondary market for other bonds that were issued long time ago, and the banks are holding them and banks are selling them. So basically just saying, well, we've got 10 billion shillings. We want to buy a bond. These are the terms. And the banks will say, yeah, okay, they bid. And you buy them. But the principle is no idle cash. Because when cash is idle, it's not making money.
So where is the economics of the money that actually runs the fund?
No, because
the expenses, how do you perform expenses?
Good.
Yes.
The way you look at the fund is we get your contributions, then the one the employer has made for you, we invest that. It earns money. It's out of the earnings that we pay our expenses. Get it, eh? That's why one of the measures of efficiency is how much of the earnings have we used in expenses. There are two measures that are in financial industry. One is called cost income ratio. How much of the earnings got eaten by the expenses? NSF Uganda today, ours is like 11%. If you look at most of the banks are running around 55%. In other words, out of the 100 shillings, they generated revenue, 55 goes to expenses. Ours is 11%. If you compare us to our neighbors in Kenya and so on, I think Kenya is 26%. I believe Tanzania is around 30-something%. There's another measure called cost of administration. How much expenses are being covered by your assets? The global measure for pensions, for funds our size, $5 billion fund, globally, there are about 310
yes,
or funds that are big, as big as us in terms of what you see. The global measure is 2.2%. In other words, I take your total expenses divided by your total assets, the number is 2.2%. Kenya, 2.7%. Tanzania, 3.3%. NSF Uganda, today, 1.16%.
Very interesting that statistics.
That is the measure of efficiency,
yes,
that we have.
That is, I think, a very interesting one. Is that what makes you the biggest in the East African market?
What happened is, from a productivity perspective, and I'm going to run a couple numbers for you, because some people haven't really understood the fund well. I just told you, the year before, 2021-22, our budget, operating budget, was 200 billion shillings. Okay? The fund grew by 1.8 trillion shillings. In other words, 200 billion shillings generated a value of 1.8 trillion. For each shilling in costs, we generated 9 times value. If you look at our staff cost on the growth of fund, for each shilling in staff costs generated 13 times value. Let me compare that to our neighbor. Same metrics, same period.
Yeah.
For each cost, for each shilling in costs, it generated 5 times value for Kenya. For each shilling that they put in staff cost, it generated 8 times value for them. In Uganda, it was 13 times. In other words, the productivity of a NSF Ugandan staff gave the member 13 times value. Kenya was 8 times value. So what makes this Ugandan staff, yes, be able to generate that amount of value that their counterparts don't? And yet,
yes,
we usually think through that. We think that the Kenyans are much better workers than we are. But I think
they are the biggest economy, yes, in East Africa.
No, but what NSF Uganda shows is, if we Ugandans are determined, we can actually be really good. We can actually beat anybody. You generate 13 times value here. They're generating 8 times value for their members. That tells you, and the worst thing I think we Ugandans have is, the Ugandan train your mind. I don't know whether it means that we don't appreciate ourselves. We are so pessimistic. We always look across things that the good things are across. But no, we can actually work. We can actually deliver for this country. And remember, the people who work in NSF, we breathe the same air from the same streets. There's no special DNA, no special blood. It's the same guys. So there's a potential for all of us as Ugandans. If we are determined and we put our hearts to it, oh no, we'll change this country.
Off to the future.
Yes.
Of the fund.
Yeah.
The leadership question.
Yes.
Do you hope to leave the fund scandal free?
Me, personally? Yes. I hope so.
And you're already involved in one.
No. You see, I'm going to tell you something. You should know even this. What sin did Jesus commit?
No sin.
And we crucified him?
Yes, we did.
So I can't guarantee somebody will not try to tarnish my name. I can't. It doesn't mean I am guilty. Because we've seen being crucified doesn't need you to be guilty. But at a personal level, I try to do my level best. That it doesn't matter whether you accuse me or you don't. Time tells. Because time is the greatest friend of the truth and the greatest enemy of a lie.
So do you see a future where the managing directors at the fund will be living scandal-free?
Yeah, why not?
Even without yourself in the equation?
No, why not? I mean, I see that. I'm optimistic it will happen.
Because it has not happened in the past.
No, well, you see, we can keep on looking at the rear mirror. But if you keep on driving and you look at the rear mirror, you'll crash. You always have to look forward. Yes.
Okay. Now, the future investment options, yes. What do they look like?
The future now, really, our purpose,
yes,
as a fund is to make lives better by making savings a way of life. But that actually is our stated purpose. Right now, we have only about 10% of Ugandan's working population saving with NSSF. We sure cannot make lives better for only 10% of Ugandans. So when we look at 2035, which is our next strategy cycle period, by 2035, we want to have at least 50% of Ugandans saving with the fund. 50% of working age Ugandans saving with the fund. We hope by that time the fund will grow to be 50 trillion shilling fund. By then, that number is magical, because that number means that about 30% of Uganda's GDP is in long-term domestic savings. And all your studies show, look at China, look at Taiwan, look at Singapore, look at Malaysia. When a country's long-term domestic savings hit 30%, they begin to take off. Why? They can self-finance their development projects. Right now, NSF is like 12% of Uganda GDP. So no wonder we keep on having a calabash borrowing from all over the map. But if we save as a nation and hit that number, we become self-financing. Now we can go to the table on our terms. So there's a magical number for that. So that's what we see the future of the fund as.
Mr. Patrick Ayota, thank you very much for honoring our invites. And for the checkpoint tonight, we have been checking on the NSSF, the National Social Security Fund. And Mr. Patrick Ayota here is very optimistic about NSSF enabling Uganda to become a self-financing. Thank you very much. I've been Vivian Kamsimi, your host. Good evening.